And you are not going to hear a better preacher than the pastor of the Mount Zion Baptist Church of Nashville, Tennessee. Pastor of leaving three churches, amen, and he is a gospel preacher. I want you to jump to your feet tonight, and I want you to point at this man of God and say, Pastor Walker, we come to hear a word from the Lord. Say, preach to us tonight in Jesus' name. I introduce to some and present to others the bishop of the Mount Zion Baptist Church of Nashville, Tennessee, the Bishop Joseph Walker. Why don't you give him a great hand of praise and say hallelujah.
Come on, give God praise, y'all. Come on, give him glory. Come on, give him glory. Come on, that'll be all right if it were for me. Come on, give God glory all over this place. Hallelujah. He's awesome. He is worthy. My God, we've come to give him worship. We've come to give him praise. My God, would you help me thank God for the angel of this house, the set man of God. Come on, help me thank God for this great man of God, Pastor Alan Turner. God bless you, man of God. And to Lady Turner, we thank God for you, and to all of these pastors and ministers who share. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. It's just good to be in the house of the Lord. I've been so blessed tonight. My goodness, I tell y'all can sing us straight on into heaven tonight. I'm telling you, we thank God for what we have heard. And of course, I certainly thank God for Tremaine Hawkins. What a legend, what a gift. And of course, my Nashville singer. There he is, Wes Morgan. He is just a blessing. My goodness, thank God for you, man of God. We thank God for your anointing. And certainly we thank God, amen, for all of you that are here to this great conference. We're just glad to be here on tonight. And of course, I certainly want to thank God. My spiritual son is here tonight. He is pastoring in San Francisco, Pastor Joseph Bryant. I thank God for him sharing with us tonight. Elder Dakar Middlebrooks and Brother Royce Moses with us tonight. I know you've come to hear a word from the Lord. I've got some things out there that I want to be a blessing to somebody with. Of course, definitely our book, Love and Intimacy, 5 Ways to Get Together and Stay Together. Now, when I talk about intimacy, I'm not talking about what you think. I'm talking about into me to see. There's a lot of people that's trying to connect with you but have no idea who you really are. Some of the folk you've been living with for a long time had even realized how much you've changed. The language has to change as you grow in relationships. So I pray that you get that. And then, of course, our latest book, Date with Destiny. It's all about coming together, understanding that God brings people into your life not by accident, but God brings people into your life to help you fulfill destiny. And, of course, this is about helping you get there. And there's a devotional out there that will be a tremendous blessing to you. We certainly thank God for you. And also, again, we thank God for so many of you, of course, who follow us on social network, on Twitter. And if you're not doing that, we send out devotional messages every morning. And of course, if you want to do that, Joseph Walker 3, please do that. Follow me. I'd love to send you some things. We do a whole lot of stuff in that area. We thank God. Let's get ready for the word of God tonight. Have you come to be blessed tonight? Amen. I want to take you over tonight to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4 tonight. Amen. Philippians chapter 4. Amen. Just a little bit more mic for the preacher tonight. Amen. Father, we thank you and we bless you tonight. We give you glory and praise for your word. And I thank you tonight that your word is so real. I pray tonight that this word will increase faith, change somebody's life. And we give you glory that it's already done. In Jesus' name, somebody say amen. A very familiar passage of scripture beginning at verse 6. The Bible says this, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true and whatsoever things are honest and just and pure and lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Look at somebody real quick. Just tell them, this will not break me. God bless you. You may be seated in the very presence of the Lord on tonight. People of God, all of us in this place will be confronted with circumstances that will stretch our faith in places to which we never imagined. Doesn't matter how long you've been in church, how long you've been saved, all of us have a universal testimony that we know what it's like to be stretched, to have our convictions challenged, to have what we believe pushed to the periphery. And even though we come in the house of the Lord and we gather in this place, we all come to that intersection of how can and I don't know. And as a Christian, it is so important for you and I to understand that when we confront these situations, that God's desire for us is that our posture is a little different than the world. You and I must look different going through circumstances than the world because we are believers of God. We cannot look like the world looks when the world holds their head down. We look to the hills of what cometh our help, because our help comes from the Lord. When the world says there is no hope, we say, but my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. We have a different posture in our pain. We have a different stance in our situation. And people of God, as you mature in your relationship with God, as you come through the maturation process of going through experiences with God, there comes a moment where you ought to just know some things by now. You ought to know by now that God would never just leave you out in the cold. You ought to know by now that if God be for you, he's more than the whole world is against you. You ought to know by now that all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purpose. By now, you ought to know that if your back is up against the wall and you have nowhere else to turn, that you're in a perfect place for a miracle. I mean, by now, there's some things you ought to just know. And it's amazing how so many folk go around saying that they're so mature in the things of the Lord, but the devil comes in and causes so many of us to be frantic and to be nervous and to wonder how things are going to work out. I'm looking at somebody right now and you're literally trying to figure out how is the way going to be made, whether or not this thing is going to open up for you, whether or not what God promised you is really going to come to fruition. And people of God, we become frantic, we become nervous, we become jittery. And the truth is, many of us, even though we have camouflaged our pain behind praise, and we know how to throw together theological phrases, and we know how to throw out little words, little catchwords to make people think we have it all together, there is a hairline fracture in all of us. There is this little crack that has begun. And many of us in this place today, if we would be honest, and we would take off our religious regalia and move out of all of our theological jargon, people would really see us for who we really are. The truth is, there is this hairline fracture that is really moving on the inside of us. And many people have no idea that we are one thing away from cracking, one thing away from breaking. We encourage everybody else. We got a word for everybody else. We got something, a prophetic word for everybody else. But deep down within us, we know we're just one phone call away from losing our own mind. Somebody gets in your car and you leave church and you get in the parking lot and cry and don't even have nobody to talk to about it. Somebody here knows what I'm talking about. You ever felt like you were right at the edge? I mean, right at the moment where you felt like you were about to just fall over. I hear the words from that great rap artist of the 70s. You remember what he said? Don't push me because I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to lose my head. It makes me wonder sometimes why I keep from going under. I believe I got somebody here tonight that knows what it's like to be right at the edge. People of God, I just come to talk to you because even though circumstances may push you to that place, it is essential for those of us who are believers to know who we are. You have got to be clear about your identity and who you are in God. Somebody declare, I know who I am. And amidst the vicissitudes of life and all the changes that will come in life, there comes a moment in your life that you have to declare that whatever has come in your life will not break you. Although it's stretching you, although it may be pushing you, there's some things inside of you that are greater than the things that are coming at you. And if God worked it out yesterday, I believe I got a witness out there. He's able to work it out today. I could
come to declare over this conference, there is victory in this house today. I said there is victory in this house today. I declare there is victory in this house today. Somebody needs to understand why you are worrying and why you are stressed. You need to know whose hands you're in. Tell somebody you're in good hands. You're in the hands of somebody who opens up the eyes of the blind. You're in the hands of somebody that makes the lame walk. You're in the hands of somebody who opens up closed doors. You're in the hands of Jehovah Jireh. You're in the hands of Jehovah Rapha. You're in the hands of El Shaddai. People of God, I give God glory because I may not know how it's going to work out, but I do know it will work out. And I come and declare today, whatever the devil is throwing in your life, it will not break you.
I want you to hear what the apostle shares in this epistle, because it is fascinating to me. It really gives us really not only an individual look at crises, but it gives us a corporate look at how we as believers come through. He declares these words, and it's important for us to see it. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Look at your neighbor, say, just pray through it. People of God, you got to understand what the apostle understood is that if you're going to get through moments like this, you have to understand the power of prayer. And when I talk about prayer now, I need you to understand something, because the reason why many of us miss this is because we communicate with God, but we're not communing with God. There are a lot of people who talk to me but have no idea who I am. That's casual communication. How you doing? What's up? How you doing, man? But have no idea of my story. But when I talk to God, I must talk to God like I have a relationship with God. I must talk to God like me and God's been hanging out a while. That's why when I talk to God, I don't have to use those long prayer preliminaries. You can always tell people who haven't really had a relationship with God or who hadn't talked to God in a while, because it takes you a long time to finally tell God what you want. You know how some people use those long prayer preliminaries that you know what they're going to say before they even say it. This evening, my Heavenly Father, this is your humble child with a bowed down head, humble heart. Thank you that last night's lying down was not my last and my mattress was not my cooling board. Somebody here knows about those long prayers. Look at your neighbor, tell them it's not the length of your prayer. Tell them it's the strength of your prayer. If you on the interstate and somebody about to run you off the road, you ain't got time for this evening, my Heavenly Father. This is your, now all you got time for is Jesus. And somebody can be a witness that right between the gas pedal and the brake, he's got enough power to bring you out. Jesus is on the main line. Stop talking so much and tell him what you need. Listen. So when I pray, I am communing with God. Listen, it means that God and I have a history, but my prayer takes into consideration my context, because Paul declares his context, be anxious for nothing. Let's understand this, because what the apostle understood is that anxiety is real. I don't care how spiritual you are. I don't care how you try to avoid this reality. Anxiety is real. If anybody had a reason to be anxious, it was the apostle Paul. In Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 and 2 and 3, his own friends were disagreeing with one another. In Philippians chapter 1 verse 15, the preachers of Rome were hating on Paul, and Paul saw the envy filled in their heart. To top it off, Paul himself was under house arrest, waiting to be arrested and waiting to go into death. His own life was hanging in the balance. But if you look at the thread that runs throughout the epistle of Philippians, there is one word that Paul keeps saying, and that one word is rejoice. Wait a minute, I just said something. That Paul's got preachers who are hating against him. Paul is facing imminent death. But throughout the book of Philippians, all Paul keeps saying is rejoice. If you can just learn how to praise God through it, somebody here can be a witness. He'll make a way out of no way. Understood something. Wait a minute, I'm going somewhere. Paul understood that if you're going to get through this, then you have to understand how to put patience over your anxiety. Tell your neighbor, put patience over your anxiety. Wait a minute, I'm going to break it down. Be anxious for nothing. That word anxious, it really comes from the Greek word marineo, which literally means to be pulled in different directions. Whenever you're anxious, you find yourself being pulled in different directions. Somebody knows what it's like to have your fears pull you in one direction and your hopes pull you in another direction. When you look at that word anxious or anxiety, the synonym for that word would be worry. The English meaning of that word literally means to be strangled. That sometimes when I find myself worrying, it feels like I'm being strangled. I'm being pulled in many directions, and it feels like I'm being strangled. And in fact, when you find yourself dealing with anxiety, it has all of these side effects. You ain't eating right. You're not taking care of yourself. You're up at 2 o'clock in the morning watching Lifetime, eating a bowl of ice cream because you can't go to bed. Somebody here knows what I'm talking about. Whenever you are anxious, it can knock the wind out of you. And people of God, what you got to understand is that you got to recognize that when you pray, you got to recognize that prayer will slow down your process. Because the reality is, when you are anxious, you want the pain to stop now. You want the situation to be dealt with now. And oftentimes in that moment is when the devil comes in and says, here is an opportunity to get a quick fix. We got too many people trying to get a quick fix. But tell your neighbor, this may take some time. Oh, I'm going to preach this anyhow. And so watch this. I want you to see it carefully. The devil comes in. The devil says, why don't you take a quick fix? Why don't you do this and do that? But you got to understand the power of waiting on God. Because God may not come when you want him to come, but he's always on time. And even if God shows up late, he's still early. Because God can show up tomorrow and still be early for yesterday. I just said something, but I think you missed it. You see, people of God, you can't hurry God. That means when I'm praying, even though I'm anxious, I gotta say, God, I'm going to rest and allow your providential will to move in my life. Let me see if I can make this make sense. Look at your neighbor, say, just wait it out, wait it out. I was in Atlanta, Georgia. I was preaching in Augusta, and on Wednesday in my church, pastor, I have 3 Bible studies on Wednesday, 12, 5, and 7. So I get back from my Bible studies. I was preaching at a conference on Tuesday night. I had all of this figured out. We got up at 4:30 in the morning to catch a 5:30 flight, got to the airport in Augusta, got to Atlanta. My flight was going to leave at 10:50. I was going to make it back to Nashville time change about 10:45. It was perfect. Good setup. Got to Atlanta, and my plane was not at the gate. All of a sudden, anxiety started choking me. Anxiety started pulling at me. Now, getting this right, I'm anointed, I'm a man of God, but I'm being honest, anxiety gripped me. Here I am trying to figure out, I gotta get back to Nashville. I got a 12 o'clock service. I got to be there. I'm in a series. I gotta get back. My plane is not at the gate. I'm nervous. But then the flight attendant came over the public address system and said, those of you that are flying on the flight to Nashville, the flight has left Baltimore and it is in range in Atlanta. Wait a minute, we start getting up. People start getting in line. The plane wasn't even at the gate, but people got an announcement that the plane had left one place and it was in range. Don't worry, I used to be slow too. You'll catch this in just a minute. Look at your neighbor and tell them your blessing has already left heaven and it's in range. Tell them, start acting like it's on the way. Start walking like it's on the way. Start talking like it's on the way. Start giving God glory like it's on. So watch this. So when I pray, wait a minute, when I pray, watch this, when I pray then, I must do this, Wes, I must come to a place that I move past my anxiety, because wrong thinking brings wrong feeling, and my circumstances will begin to be distorted, because the truth is, it's not as bad as it looks. You see, the greatest thief to your joy is anxiety. You think that the circumstances that are going on around you is what's robbing you of your
joy. But anxiety is an inside job. It is corroding you. It is causing you to miss what God has for your life. And Paul gives the antidote. And the antidote is that you gotta pray about everything. Tell your neighbor, pray about everything. People of God, that's what the hymn writer said. Oh, what needless pains we bear. Oh, because we don't take everything to God in prayer. In other words, don't worry about anything. Pray about everything. I said, don't worry about anything, but pray about. I don't take nothing for granted. You see, there used to be a time I just pray for big things, and I wouldn't pray for the little things because I figured they just work themselves out. But I'm at a point in my life now that I recognize if you neglect the little things, they will grow up and become big things. So I don't take nothing for granted. I pray about, should I know this person? Should this person have my number? Should I connect with that individual? Should I go to that place? I don't take nothing for granted. And some of you would have saved years off your life if you had prayed about some of the decisions you made. Am I talking to anybody up in here today? Tell your neighbor, pray about it.
Listen, because when I pray, listen, he says, pray with supplication. I'm going somewhere. I promise you, I'm going somewhere. Pray with supplication that I can be specific when I pray. With supplication, watch this. When I talk to God, I'm being very specific that this is not going to break me. So when I talk to God, I'm being specific. But wait a minute. In order for me to understand what Paul says here, but with thanksgiving, somebody shout, with thanksgiving. This is the prayer of faith. Because people of God, listen, because I know him, based on what I've been through with him, when I pray for a thing, I begin to thank him for the thing before I get the thing, because I know the thing is already done. Wait, you missed that. So then when I pray for the thing, I step over and say thank you, even if the thing is not in my hand. God says, because you said thank you, I put it in your hand, and that's my way of saying you welcome. Did you miss that? You got to learn how to thank God for stuff you see in the spirit before it even manifests in the natural. That's what I've learned how to do, people of God. Somebody here know God is a way maker. Wait a minute. So I got to pray through it. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, begin to thank God for it in advance. Wait a minute. I'm coming back to that. Hold on. But I want you to see what he says in the next verse. He says in verse 7, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding. Somebody just shout peace, peace. Now, people of God, what the enemy wants to do is systematically, methodically break you down. It's not just one thing. It's compound issues that will frustrate your mind. The devil will cause a traffic jam on the avenue of your mentality, and it'll rob you of your peace, and you'll find yourself closer to a breakdown than you ever thought you were. And that's why it's important to understand God's presence, people of God, because when I understand this, I recognize that no matter what I go through, I recognize that God is not going to let me go through it by myself. People of God, listen, this peace that passeth all understanding says this, that the devil can drag me through a lot of stuff, but in the midst of it, my response will never make sense. Okay, I'm going to need some witnesses right here. Will you just look at somebody, tell them you have no idea of the stuff I'm going through. Tell them, but my response will never make sense to you. Yeah, you're going to get this in just a minute. I promise you, you're going to get this in just a minute. The peace of God that passeth all understanding. The way I act going through what I go through can't be explained. The fact that somebody here tonight's been laid off and still writing out a tithe check talking about God is blessing me. And that don't make no sense.
It just can't be explained. The fact that somebody had somebody to walk out on them and tell them they would never be nothing without them, but they up in here tonight saying, but God is still good to me and I'm God's chosen vessel, that just don't make no sense. The fact that somebody got a bad prognosis from the doctor, but you up in here saying I'm healed and I'm believing God for my breakthrough, that doesn't make any sense.
See, it's beyond understanding. You see, Pastor, my response is beyond cognitive comprehension. I've become a philosophical perplexity. I'm an analytical anomaly. See, when you have this kind of peace, it don't make sense to people because people watch you and have no idea of the stuff you're going through, and they make assumptions about you, and they look at you, and there are folk hating on you that don't have no idea of your story. 2003, I was married to an extraordinary woman who ended up getting a terminal cancer. And at age 37, the wife who helped me build my church from 175 to thousands went home to be with the Lord at age 37. While she was sick, I was preaching to God's people. I was on the pulpit preaching, encouraging everybody else, but going home in the valley, nobody had any idea that I had a hairline fracture. I was just one thing away from just cracking. People look at you, and I'm watching everybody else get healed, but it wasn't happening for me at home. I was living in a public paradox, encouraging God's people, watching breakthroughs at church, but then watching my own wife deteriorate in front of me. Wait a minute, I'm trying to help somebody about the peace that passeth all understanding. I had to keep showing up. I had to keep on preaching. And then at age 37, my wife passed away on a Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. I ran to the window with tears in my eyes, crying. And here comes the devil, because the devil loves to get you in isolation so he can interrogate you. And the devil said, what you gonna preach now? What you gonna tell God's people now? You've been going around the world talking about God's a healer. God can make a way. What you gonna say now, preacher? I said, wait a minute, devil. You must not know the peace I got. I may have tears in my eyes, but though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. I believe I got some folk up in here right now. When you look back over your life and some of the things you've been through, it just don't make no sense. We got some folk in this conference tonight that have learned how to give God glory for some of the stuff others of you are still complaining about. Somebody can say, Lord, I thank you for my fake friends, because now I know who my real friends are. I thank you for the time I was broke, because every dollar I get, I'm going to give you glory. I thank you for my mountains. I thank you for my valleys. I thank you for the storm you brought me through. If I never had a problem, I wouldn't know what faith in you. But through it all, I've learned how to live. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Woo, wait a minute. Wait a minute. But this peace, he says, will keep your hearts in your mind. So you can't really appreciate this kind of message until you've been in a place where you almost lost your mind. We got too many pretentious folk in church who act like they always got it together. Like you came out your mama's womb speaking in tongue with a tambourine. But look at your neighbor, tell them, I've been there where I almost lost my mind. People of God, what I give God glory for. You see, there are a whole lot of people in this place today. And some of you, all you do is thank God for the house. You thank God for the car. You thank God for the promotion. You high five because you got a man or a woman. But can I tell you what I thank God for? And I believe I got a few witnesses up in here today. When I look at all I've been through in my life, I thank God that he kept me. Look at your neighbor, just tell him, he kept me. He kept me from Skid Row. He kept me from walking the street late at night. I give God glory because I don't even look like what I've been through. Tell your neighbor, you look well kept.
That's why
you have to remember to keep it positive.